I can tell something about these, yeah. As you said, I was like marineology training, and then I was always passionate about science, and I did like a lot of doctors just to like science to get their titles, right? I was really passionate about projects, so, and I really came up with new ideas and stuff. I always did like 2 days a week in basic medical imaging sciences, and then I realized that there's not everything like it could be, you know, there's no links into references in the paper. Why is that the case? Well, and then I thought about open science and all these things, and friends of mine founded the ResearchGate. It was like a crazy idea, very early stages. So I started to think about open science, opening science, and then, well, as she said, the next revolution is the blockchain revolution in science. Yeah. Okay, so we had like this last week, this 4 days of unconference in Wien, Zurich, and Zug, where almost 50% of the blockchain for science projects worldwide came. We had like from artifacts from North America and two other guys from North America and Korea and from Belarus, and they were all talking together, like what's in there, what's the status of blockchain for science. And I will first go over what is actually blockchain, and you will like hear something that you heard a couple of times already, but there will be also new aspects. And then I get into the crypto economy for science, and then I like showcase a project and how they could all work together, yeah? Maybe, potentially, in person, potentially. And some pain points of blockchain. Okay, so what is blockchain, yeah? Well, it's a chain of blocks, okay? We heard this a lot of times, but I want to air the hashes, the references into the previous block, right? And I compare this to the term internet. We had this today, and I really like this comparison. Internet was a protocol or some interfaces between networks, right? But nowadays, we use the term internet much wider. The same happened with blockchain, yeah? It's not longer the chain of blocks, yeah? It's something, it's much more, yeah? And I like the comparison from another perspective, like, there was one guy who mentioned that blockchain, the only thing that blockchain does is basically doing decentralized time stamping of something, right? And this comparison is as useful or as useless or meaningful or meaningless as to say the internet just like transfers bytes from one computer to the other, yeah? Okay, well, it's the things that we make out of it. And I like this comparison because like the internet is a connection of the computers and blockchain is the time of negotiated statuses in this network, you know, the chain, right? And I actually had this slide in there that blockchain is just a method of decentralized time stamping of anything. I removed it because I thought like these are too many abstractions, right? So, well, okay, now we came to it. And I booked my flights in the internet, right? So I can make some meanings out of the bytes, and this is the same what we do with the negotiated status of blockchain, yeah? Blockchain can be interpreted as a way online services or databases are organized. Now we had this distributed, I will like talk about decentralized. They can be immutable, they don't have to be, and it's not in reality immutable means append only. That I just, every changes that I do to the system, I can't remove. It's just like paper. It resembles like what paper means to our society. I sign a contract, I delete something and it leaves a trace. Blockchain under certain conditions does the same in computer memory, in computer space. If we have an Excel sheet at home, we open it, we delete a number, a researcher deletes a number, maybe the mouse was just sick, you know, the p-value is not reached. If I drop this mouse, and I will have the p-value and get a Nature publication, right? In blockchain world, this wouldn't be possible because there wouldn't be a trace that there was another mouse, okay? So this is like, and without a trusted third party. And what's like an important thing, and this was not mentioned like in the right way, is like blockchain makes an internet service transparent and provable to the outside. To the outside, yeah? And a service runs and advertised, like built in stone, yeah? what we, it's so common for us that we trust an internet service that it does what it says it does. Like Facebook says that it only increases the amount of likes if somebody clicks the like button. But we just have to trust them, right? There's no way of us really knowing this. In blockchain world, this is different. In the easiest form, it's seen in Bitcoin. Everybody can see that you only can send Bitcoin from one address to the other one if you have a cryptographic proof of the private key that belongs to this address, right? And this is like interesting for science as well, because we don't distribute research money accordingly to the amount of retweets or likes, because our government would never accept to rely on a trusted third party, such as ResearchGate, to measure the amount of likes that other researchers put on it, because we all know that they could just sit down with an admin password and just change the amount of likes, okay? So as soon as there is a monetary interest, blockchain has like value to like make a service provable to the outside, okay? Well, this is like, as blockchain is a socio-techno-economical, legal, and cultural evolution or revolution, a fascination of the of game theory, strong cryptography, tech, and money, and it's a hype. Yeah, we had this a couple of times, and I don't have anything like I have a problem with hypes, right? And I want to use the hypes that is associated with blockchain to piggyback stuff on the hype to get this out into the research world, right? If we make it right and use it. So I want to use the hype, not abuse it, that as some people do in ICOs and scams. Let's use the hype to like fix something in the science world, okay? And okay, this we didn't have in this form, like what is blockchain? You can also like include this into blockchain, like we had like this pseudonymous identity. Well, what you do in blockchain is you kind of keep control over the system in a way that you keep the private key under your own control, and every change to the system, you sign. If you log in into Facebook, we have a password, of course, but then we trust Facebook to do whatever they want to do with my identity, right? In blockchain world, we keep, like as Konrad said, like for example, the key in the MetaMask browser plugin, or even in the Internet of Things in a ship, and we sign every transaction or change to the database. And if you don't like the change, it's not going to happen because we don't sign the transaction, okay? This could also be subsummarized under blockchain. Konrad said this already, like, I have another diagram for the same thing, like blockchain is a new way to look at computer security. You all know these things, right? And in blockchain world, through game theory, economic incentives, cryptography, all these things, like Bitcoin just runs in the wide open, yeah? Everybody can like do everything, like spam system, it doesn't work. It's so economic incentives, it's so secure that it's always better to act in a good way with the Bitcoin system, yeah? So it can be seen as a new way to look at computer security. And then blockchain is, well, we all know that somebody runs a service. He can, like, on the hardware somewhere, he can change the service or manipulate the data as he wants to. In blockchain world, it is no longer the case. Of course, blockchain systems run on some hardware somewhere, but whoever controls the hardware doesn't have any control over the service automatically. Yeah, this is a new aspect. And so the detachment. In the most beautiful form, this is like in crypto clouds, Konrad like named one, like Filecoin or Swarm. It's like, you know that like there is no cloud, right? There is only somebody else's computer. There is no cloud. But in blockchain crypto cloud, there can be a real crypto cloud where you put the data somewhere, nobody has control over it. Only us who has a private key, okay? So this is a new abstraction. And, well, blockchain is unnecessary. We have heard this a couple of times, yeah? And yeah, that's completely right. You know, blockchain can't do anything a perfectly trusted third party wouldn't be able to do, right? If we have a perfectly trusted research gate or whatever, and we can trust millions at it, we could like use it and we would be easy, had no scalability problems, nothing at all, right? And if it would be perfectly secure and like firewall protected, there was the, okay, so blockchain is completely unnecessary. But it's like asking for the Leviathan, the benevolent king, the perfect king, you know, that is good to everybody and only had best intentions. We don't have it, so we have democracy, right? And so maybe blockchain will add something. Well, anyway, I have a perfect third party for you that I want to advertise. And it's between the 5th and 6th of November of the first International Blockchain for Science Conference. The evening will be when will be the third party. And I want to invite you to the conference, take your attention for this. Okay? Okay, well, this was a little joke. And blockchain, I have another reason why blockchain is unnecessary. Well, the computer services that will compromise all these things that we said might at the end not be based on an actual blockchain data structure, because there are other ways to achieve provability, distribution, and decentralization. Yeah? So we might use the term blockchain totally independent from the data structure that we presented in the beginning. Okay? And then I want to talk to you about that we should maybe include even more things into the term, into the umbrella term blockchain, especially if you talk about blockchain for science. This would be like distributed file systems that are based on cryptography, DLT and IPFS, which are slightly similar but a little bit different. They are distributed, encrypted, and has like other similarities to blockchain systems. And then I want to like talk about novel data processing concepts, because what we do at the moment is we basically, I will show like in a more clear way later. Today we like just like fix people who we allow to like get patient data or subject like sensitive, privacy sensitive research data to do everything they want to do with it. Yeah? So in theory they could do everything. We trust them, like ESIC permissions, like trust them only to do certain analysis and publish certain values like averages. Maybe in blockchain world we'll be able to like change this. I come to that later. And then I would love to include trusted hardware concepts into blockchain, because it has to do with cryptography, and blockchain can be used to secure and test whether the hardware is still acting in the right way. And then the thing is about decentralized data marketplaces. So imagine somebody like provides the data, and artificial intelligence algorithm uses data and pay for the training on it. Yeah? There's like a Project Ocean, and they can be like, they can use blockchain for these micropayments. So it would all be beautiful to like integrate them into the blockchain hype and get them out into the research landscape using the blockchain. Okay, and then we talked about the term decentralization a couple of times. We had this term, yeah? And most of the time we talk with people about decentralization, they are not interested in the technical decentralization. Amazon, Google is highly distributed in a way certainly decentralized. Yeah? Well, there might be some 5 plugs that I can pull and I will crash like Google, at least in North America or something, but so it's like, what they mean if they want to have decentralization, they often say that they don't want to have obscure single point of failure that are under control of a company. Or they want to have an independency of the service and a control over the service, as I said. Like they don't want to have their data behind paywalls, right? They don't want to have the data stored at one place, at one university, where when the university disappears, the data is gone, right? This is what people mean with decentralization. And we, like, another speaker like referred to it, the power over the data, right? It should be distributed. Or we don't want to have constraining business models. The technical decentralization is not so important, yeah, to the people. So the people that are excited about decentralization, okay? Do you agree with this in some way? Okay. And well, and then let's put the whole crypto economy under blockchain as well. So you know what the crypto economy is sort of, right? All these tokens, ICOs, even more tokens, and yeah, like ICOs, even more, 200 million within 3 hours. And well, crypto economy is based on that blockchain, can easily create a bulletproof of something, of a computer variable, which can be named token, which can be named coin. So a token in blockchain world is basically just a variable in the smart contract or Bitcoin address, yeah? It's all the same. And you can like prove that there are only so and so many of these tokens because there's an upper limit of the variable, right? And this is, and what is blockchain, what's new with blockchain is, I mean, this was all before possible. You can just write down a piece of paper and say, I give like 200,000 or something to him and to him and to him. This was long possible, just long before blockchain. But the thing is that we can do this now at near zero costs, right? And it can be still be valid in the internet and then everywhere. Yeah, and this was not possible before blockchain. And without traditional trusted third parties, and here we have a paper contract, lawyer, notary, banks, or stock exchanges, okay? So we can create a bulletproof something of, yeah, maybe a value, can acquire some value without a traditional trusted third party. And then we saw this token evolution. There were first like protocol level tokens. So this was actually how Bitcoin, the beauty in Bitcoin is, in my opinion, that it's a self-referential system. So you have like the miners that like maintain the blockchain, and on this blockchain are Bitcoins, and the Bitcoins are given back to the miners as a reward, right? This was the earliest stage token systems. And then there was a phase when people just created some tokens and did an ICO. I think like the first Filecoin was something like this, or there was another
Namecoin.
Namecoin. Yeah, Namecoin, for example. Yeah, they had some functions, and there was like no ICO hype, not so much money involved, so it was kind of a nerd geek thing. Nobody had, like, they collected a few millions and did their job. I say Madesafe did the same, like 4 or 5 years ago, right? So they just created a token and sold it, and everybody was kind of happy. But then it's like all this ICO craze happened, and the lawyer and the legal entities looked into it, and now we have like this utility token, which are basically vouchers or security token, and I don't know what the status in the countries is at the moment, but we can like see that in the mid future we will have much more legal structures, and I think in the long term future, like the whole stock market and everything will go to smart contracts, yeah. But what the setup will be and things, you know, it remains unclear, okay. But this is like the vision, because it's just too appealing to have something like that, right? Okay, but this is okay, but this is sort of where we had this inflow of like millions because of the blockchain hype, and then there were like crypto billionaires who spent like on some nice projects tens of millions because they wanted to like get their money somewhere into some value. So we had like this ridiculous high ICOs, but everything else is basically only this little advantage that I said, that we can like create these bulletproof tokens, but we have like basically it's the same old economy. And I question myself whether it's now time for some new exciting value propositions, right? There was a post by Vitalik and by other people that say now we have like the equivalent that stocks are to companies, to open science, open source projects. You know, imagine you invest in a Linux coin or in something else, you know. There were blog posts that the innovator's dilemma could be solved with it. Couldn't there be like value propositions like, let's invest in peer-to-peer mobility with a peer-to-peer coin, or some open science coins that will like, you know, like, can, or will we still stick with this old value propositions? That's the question. And then people say like the crypto economy is a more onboarding economy in terms of that we have like people The more people contribute to Ethereum, the more value the Ethereum gets. It's not like Facebook where they like create a walled garden and a silo and a few people get rich. It's more in Ethereum, the more people openly contribute, the more value the whole ecosystem gets, okay? The question is that really the case in this new economy? This would be a good thing because then we would really like have a system that would like support real cooperation, right? Well, and now I question myself, what's in for science with the blockchain and research? This is like we all like read it quickly. You all know that, okay? I don't have it to go through it, yeah. So we have legacy structures that are grown, centrality, unlimited media breaches. We work digital, but we have to like copy it from Word to PDF to create it to a software, to a publisher, or to the web page, like download it behind the firewall, like, ugh. And then we have like these artificial competitions, grants. I mean, governments want to distribute their tax money in a very reliable and responsible way, right? So they set up like these competitions for visa, artificial state competition. But they are like, they went wild, right? They use so much time of researchers that there's one guy who actually claimed that more money is used or more resources are used to write all the grant applications than the money that is actually distributed for the ERC-20 grants, yeah? This was all in best intentions, yeah? But this is too much overhead. And then we have like the problem that only certain parts of the research process is open end. We have like how we measure research, it's in the hand of like obscure third parties, yeah? How the impact factor is calculated and everything, yeah? Okay, but I'm not pessimistic. And I'm not one of these open science hippies and anarcho, crypto anarchist, and so we just want to like say that science is fun and we respect science and scientific culture and we respect like how it's like integrated in people's lives and career paths. And this is a very important thing. We want to build something great and not destroy existing stuff. We will build something that might amend the system on the very long term will maybe replace existing systems, okay? And who is our enemy here? Who is our enemy? Against who are we fighting? Lisa? No, just joking. No joking, it's like us. It's us and the science culture, right? So it's not that we just like point at the publishers and say, the business model and everything might have affected our science culture in a certain way, but it's a very long discussion, right? So it's us who adopted all this, who only published full paper, who like maintained this grant writing system and everything, and it's a complex thing, right? Like life is complex, okay? But the exciting thing in this blockchain for science revolution, and which is different from all the other science revolutions that have happened in the past, like name it open science, science 2.0, the open access phase, the social networking phase of science, is that this time funding is affected, right? And like blockchain is about money, and I'm like showing cases later. So the crypto economy for science is already happening. And where the money goes, the honey flows, right? So if we direct this in a very constructive way, we can really change science for the first time, I arrogantly claim, okay? That by this like online technology development, we might be able to really change something, yeah? Well, this is the research, we need to get some more work done, like 5 minutes of like hard work, and then comes fun again, and then an outlook. Okay, this is like, I put like where blockchain can like in the research circle help, or I envision something, but not it's an experiment, right? You can't do the experiment in the blockchain world, right? Everything else you could do in theory in a blockchain database, yeah? Which would be beautifully connected, you know, in a future vision, right? But not the experiment itself, okay? We can like save our data, timestamp it in a blockchain database, but we have like this real world blockchain interface problem. And if you find something that a database, a lot of things that we discuss are basically this real world blockchain interface problem, because the computer system can't prove anything about the real world, right? there needs to be always a trusted third party, a sensor or something that brings it into the computer system. If you would find a way to do this, there will be a few Nobel Prizes associated with it. I'm pretty sure, you know, this would be like really beautiful. But we can't do this. Okay, so what is blockchainified? What could blockchainified science be? Okay, go through this diagram, it's worth 10 seconds and you'll understand it. So this is basically like how we do the research study, and this is like how we did science for centuries and decades. We do our stuff and then we just publish a paper, right? And this is like things that we pre-register studies, so that you can't do like ex post facto hypothesizing is especially important for like pharmaceutical approval studies. You analyze the data and then you see where it's dependent, where are like significant things, and then you claim that this was your hypothesis which was just proved. This is like wrong and it's a very bad thing for science. This is like, and then we have like this open data science where you publish your research data, but you publish it at the end together with your paper, yeah? In between there's this valley of trust where we have to trust the researcher not to delete an outlier and not to delete something that doesn't fit his narrative, okay? If we would do blockchainified science and publish constantly, maybe every day we timestamp our Excel sheet, we wouldn't be able just to like fake the data or drop something and delete something. It doesn't mean that the research data has to be open from the very beginning. We just like save, timestamp it, and then we publish the timeline at the end, right? The data. And it's very hard to fake. You would have to fake at the sensor and like really think about data distribution and everything. It's a big problem. So this would be, this would increase the trust into science data a lot. And then I come to trusted hardware. We have like in our iPhones, we have like this thing, we have like our fingerprint sensor, and it goes to a hardware chip. And this is like built into the private key of this hardware chip. There's a hardware firewall, so the system can't see the private key. It only leaks encrypted and can be deciphered with a public key that is outside. So there's no way for like whatever to like leak the fingerprint, original fingerprint data. And then it actually goes to the Apple cloud, keychain, blockchain, but there are some dependencies, and this Apple system, well, it's all based on the trusted Apple servers, but it has some similarities with blockchain systems, right? And if you would put something like this in our microscopes, we could always prove that there was no data stolen, the data was not manipulated and everything. And I don't think a researcher that like looks a little bit biased with a glass of red wine at his Excel sheet, like short, like to Nature publication, dropping one number, is different from a researcher who would actually go there and like manipulate the hardware. No, researchers don't do this, right? They might look biased at the data, okay? Biased, as like in one of the Nature publications, why like most studies were not reproducible, yeah? Okay, and then we can do all the data processing through smart contracts, and we could call this smart evidence. We just like make the decisions, like save them on the blockchain, have some research data that goes to post-processing analysis, and then we accept or reject our research hypothesis. In real world, there are like a few things, like experiments can go wrong, and we have to, but it's just like a general idea how it could be done, yeah? And then there's this idea of this new subject privacy that I just mentioned. So we have like, in healthcare, we have like, unlimited amount of data sets that we can't use for research, right? Because people didn't consent, and the ethic, you have to like apply for ethics commissions, agreement before we can use the research data. Because what we do today with research data is, with patient data, is we anonymize it or not. Like genome is not possible, it's like a fingerprint, you can't anonymize it. And then we like give it to some people that we trust to, in theory, they can do everything with it, but we trust them just to like release averages, like the blood pressure of Bostonians at 55 years, you know, so they analyze it after some beta blockers and stuff, and versus non-beta blocker taking ones, and they just release the average amount of the average blood pressure, right? So imagine we would change this thing to, let's get the research, let's get the patient data and give it to something that can provably do only certain things with the data. A smart contract that is secured by a blockchain system. And we send all the Bostonians' blood pressure data from all hospitals to the smart contract, and the smart contract averages the data and releases 4 weeks later, provable. Well, at the moment, the smart contract systems are evaluated on all nodes, so the research data had to, it would be a catastrophe. But they are like researchers that work on projects where you do like a combination with zero knowledge proof and at the moment still trusted hardware so that you can prove what's actually happening with the calculation. They want to build such systems. So, and I think here the blockchain of distributed trust would be a perfect correlation of the responsibility to society that we have like for the patient privacy, right? We don't want to trust one entity with relying on making the system secure, yeah? So this is just an outlook and a vision. There are some publications that go into this direction. So an inverse way of like handling data security. Okay, this is like you all know this. We like store it in one of these fancy systems. Some are distributed, very interesting systems, and some have like blockchain incentive systems so that you keep the data, yeah? They work, and don't work, yeah? To make them really decentralized, it's very difficult. And I don't know whether it's really solved the problem yet, but they are like good approaches, and it's like a tough thing, right? But the question whether we need to store all research data on the blockchain is like not the question, right? We just use timestamps, yeah? And then we have like dynamic publications, we do micro contributions, we just publish everything that we acquire, the moment we acquire the data and secure it, timestamp is in the blockchain system. We don't want to trust Wikipedia or ResearchGate with timestamping this because I might win a Nobel Prize for it later. We have peer review systems on the blockchain with incentivation for peer review with blockchain tokens. Okay, now the exciting part starts. Science funding is affected by the blockchain revolution, okay? We can have data marketplaces. So whoever is good at analyzing data can like as a service analyze the data for somebody else, or you rent microscope time from somebody. Well, they have been there and centralized, decentralized on the blockchain, they would also work. Yeah, there are some projects. Okay, and I promise you the crypto economy in science is already active, it's already happening. There was the first ICO for a research project. They were successful in the first round. And I just said now we want to like influence science, so we are working on good practices for ICOs in research. We just come up with a living document, we will go through a review process, we will say no excessive marketing, and all the research projects should be blockchain open in the end, right? So not only open access publication, but like every step in the research project should be open, right? Otherwise don't invest into this ICO, right? And you have changed lines already, easily, yeah? The government agencies don't see ICOs at the moment, yeah, for research. But once we have like a very nice looking guideline ready, then if they look at it, we have it ready, okay? And the other thing is, why don't we do micro ICOs for research ideas? Today, we do our research, and if you have an idea, we just like to take some resources and money from some other projects, and well, this is how it works. Why don't we have an idea? And like, I talk to people at lunch. You want to contribute? Yes. Okay. Good. And then, if it's like €3,000, and it worked out, I can like do the next day at maybe €30,000, and I can say like, if this works out, and if I publish on the blockchain the results and the tokens get more valuable, the better the results are, and actually you can sell your tokens. It's a different from standard crowdfunding. And we can make some value proposition. We have to have a legal framework for that. But imagine you say, I have this crazy idea, if a patent publication comes out of it, I give 30% of all the revenue to the token holders. Yeah? So, and what is happening with ideas today? I just like go at lunch and talk to my research peers, give you my idea, test it maybe in the lab, and the first time my idea is timestamped is when I send the facts to the patent office. Yeah, it's the first time that my name is associated with it. Yeah, this is pretty late, right? Because it takes some effort to like write this patent and everything. In blockchain world, it could like the moment I have the idea, I timestamp my name and everything, you know, and I can like, it can be much earlier, right? With zero cost. Because nobody really takes effort for all kind of like stupid ideas to like go to the technology transfer and file a patent, okay? Yeah, and then we have like this complex systems, token system, incentivation systems that can be built in a blockchain system where actually money flow goes through references, links, data that is used. If something is cited, the expertise increases of some researchers, and we can do this because it's provable how we do it with smart contracts. If we would like rely on ResearchGate, we would know that they can just like fake everything and just like manipulate it in theory. So this could be the first time that we actually can build an open science ecosystem, a new incentive structures. And we know, well, these systems can obviously also be gamed, probably, and manipulated, but maybe less than the current systems. Yeah? And the current system is so off that probably every system that we will build that is somewhat good will be better than the current system. Okay, now I have like 3 more minutes of like the pain points of blockchain and science, okay? Identity, we discussed this, yeah? But I want to like say something. Everybody loves ORCID or the projects. Yeah, we have ORCID ID, super, ORCID ID. The problem is, yeah, ORCID ID, what is it at the moment? It's just your name in some publications, right? But you don't get any money from your ID, right? So there's little incentive to create socket puppets, fake IDs, yeah? But imagine we start with blockchain ecosystems, and there are several projects that are building on it, and you create fake researchers that upvote you, right? Or you get some money. And as soon as you put economic pressure on an ID, there will be much more interest for people to like create fake IDs. And I don't know whether ORCID is prepared for this. Yeah? This is not now, not tomorrow, but once the systems are running, and there's like this video project by Springer Nature, Digital Designs, they already get token. Yeah? So I don't know how many people sit at ORCID and review whether there's a real person that applied for an ID, right? I know that at ResearchGate there are like 30 people looking at this, yeah? So there might be a point for social networks to actually, or as universities, to prevent cryptographic proofs that this is a human, yeah? They could like maybe be new technical, new trusted third parties. Okay, the blockchain set up for science. How would it look like? Well, we have trusted third parties. And our attacker is not a government level. Yeah? So we don't need mining in research, yeah, in science. We don't need mining blockchains in science. And we already, if we want to have a mining blockchain for science, we already have it. The humanity's most secure and immutable database, also called Bitcoin, which might even survive a nuclear war, some people claim, yeah, is already there, and we can use it to timestamp our research result actually for free, and we can like put gigabytes every day through Mercury hash into Bitcoin and timestamp it at zero costs, okay? So it doesn't depend on the amount of people using it or the amount of data, yeah, the costs, yeah? And for sure, there will be different blockchain systems that we will use in science. And one that we already use is Bitcoin, yeah? And some consortium chains for some application. And it's an ongoing development. And the question is, how technically decentralized do the science blockchain actually have to be? Because it's not so much interesting that the decentralization is referring to the technical setup. Is more the liberation of data, of the, that nobody can fake our data, that the trusted third party that runs the hardware has no control over the data. And this brings me to the Ruhr triangle. We already had this in a couple of versions. It's like you need to hear it once, you understood forever. So in every distributed system, you have availability. That means like how many transactions you can do per time. You have consistency, that the system is everybody has the same information, and how decentralized, partition resistant the system is. And this is a physically proven computer science theory. You can only have two of both. Two of both. Yeah, whereas banking, like banks are allocated. Here, 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 there, more here, or more here. Banks, where you put Bank of America or Visa, here? Yeah, okay. Yeah. There's banking, yeah? Facebook, Dropbox, everything is there, right? It's centralized, highly consistent. There's your account, nobody messes with your account. You're using your account from your ATM, the same amount of money on your account, right? Bitcoin is highly consistent, yeah? But it's decentralized, but it's not available, right? The amount of transactions in Bitcoin are only 7 or so per second, depending on how you measure it, yeah? So, and this is not, has not been squared, the system. There were some tricks and tweaks and a lot of marketing speech, and there are things in the middle that do some of this and like obscure lack in other fields a little bit, you know? So, what one solution is like Dash is using supernodes where something is put at stake, this is a method. So you have like more centrality in the system. It's not as distributed as Bitcoin, you have more centrality. And then it's like, Konrad already said, it's like trusted channels or state channels. So what you do is you open up, or your second layer as you named it, between nodes, you put some 100 euro, 500 euro, and you trust from here to here for 100 euro, from here to here 300 euro, and then you can send like very quickly money through this system, like forward, backward, several times per second without any costs. But the thing is, well, it still looks decentralized, but the availability is reduced because you can only do transactions up to 300 euro. You can't send 1 million, okay? In Bitcoin, I could send 1 million all in a sudden to somebody, yeah? Okay, so there are, and there's a lot of marketing speech. For example, IOTA is not blockchain but scalable, right? They have like consistency problems at times, and they are not decentralized because they have like super nodes that like decide which part of the tangle is the right one, yeah? Okay, we had this. And the thing is that for sure we will have centralized services in science to prevail for meaningless transactions in terms of downloads from a database, like data providers that are like that provide actually the research data and all this like. So we will for sure have centralized services. Okay, and this like we discussed in Vienna, like the blockchain setup for science would be delegate proof of stake. So we would put some tokens and ask universities, government agencies to run a service, a blockchain service on their computer. And I came up with the idea, other blockchain science for science project came up with the same conclusions, yeah? So why not do this, right? We don't need mining, we have like trusted third parties. The thing is that these trusted third parties can't control the data, right? We only need to trust them that they run a node. We don't need to trust them to actually don't manipulate our data. It's different from classic cloud providers, right? The problem is we will run into legal issues here. The university. I thought this is no problem at first. Like, just have some, like, run a node. It's just like a university runs a FTP server, it's not responsible for the, what people upload there, right? In crypto, whatever, blockchain world, it's like even less data. But the problem is, there are tokens associated, right? So it gives the university tokens. And they will, like, have a problem with it because we don't know what these tokens mean. Okay, so this will be a problem and we need to, like, discuss this. And then, of course, in every system that we build, like ecosystem, we will have system gamers and the trust in research results, where can it be solved? We have user interface challenges, big, if we like have this ecosystem and show the value flow through a knowledge network, big problems just to display this, big challenges. We have like, we need to like get wording and communication right, and well, these are the implementations and projects that work on blockchain for science implementation worldwide. Like almost half of them have been in Vienna and Zurich, and on different levels, they come from different directions, very good teams, and all this, like, it's a real ecosystem. And they really, most of them come from really interesting aspects. Like yesterday we heard Nobelatech, right? They like want to use the crypto economy to make dormant IP available. And we heard about artifacts who like connect like the artifacts and give it back to the community. And then there's, for example, Science Matters. They have like a micro contribution journal concept, built a blockchain backend. Akasha, a social network that runs on the blockchain, wants to go into the crypto economy for science. So they come from, most of them come from very different, DEIP works on a very elaborate crypto economy token system for research incentivation. So this kind of reminded me in the Web 2.0 revolution for science. Guess what is this? This is a competition analysis of ResearchGate from which year? What do you think? Which year is this? 2003, 2008, or 2014? Huh? Okay.
Okay.
This is 8, I'm saying. Yeah, it's 2008, okay? 2003, this was too early. Okay, but these are like count the amount of social networks that were there for science, right? These are all social networks that were there for science. And some prevailed. Nature Networks was actually there. They were kind of good, yeah? Much more. So this was a, but they failed, or they like went into ResearchGate, or they were combined and everything, yeah? Because Web 2.0 systems have to cash out on a central point of failure, have to create a walled garden around their software, became the new evil, you know? And so maybe the token economy or the blockchain economy will prevent this, and maybe they can really work together and provide all the parts. There will be ICOs, and there should be several ICOs, there should be several legal entities. We don't want to have one system and do a mega open science ICO to open up science for 200 million, and then our lawyer goes to Hawaii, you know, for a nice life, yeah? For good, you know, it happens in ICOs, right? To Tezos, for example, okay? So this could be the slice that all these things, like ecosystems, provide together and really build the open science ecosystem. And we should unslice the pie and build this open science ecosystem together. And we founded the International Society of Blockchain for Science for this, to like bring this project together. And this is the funding picture of our last day from the conference. And this is a list of Blockchain for Science projects. This is a very active open science ecosystem Telegram group. You joined it, they're almost all projects. This is a list of all the projects, and this is the conference. And thank you very much for your attention. Yeah.
You are most welcome. Thank you so much. Okay, questions? We're ready to go. We're questioned out. Okay, fantastic. Thank you very much. Before you go, I'd like to thank everybody, all of our speakers today. It was fabulous. And FACE will like to keep this conversation going. So.